Good. Welcome to my small story time over lunchtime. My name is Sebastian Oege. Hi, everyone. let's get start right ahead. Okay. Let's start with this statement: DevOps is a game changer. So, in last years, I worked as a IT consultant with the focus on DevOps, and this time I tell you what I encountered over the years and how you can do things to not experience the same. So, good. Let's start with a short comic strip. I think this one tells a lot what one can experience. By the way, I love this monkey users comic strips because they are so true. In the end, you start with something clean, and sooner or later you experience a whole mess, and again and again. So my talk is about DevOps can be a game changer if done right, especially the last part is important. So why bother? I think you all know more or less what DevOps means, but for me it means faster delivery speed and especially less pain for the involved parties. You cannot imagine how much you can suffer in this environment. Generally spoken, it's more like the promises: improved the deployment frequencies, faster time on market, lower failure rate, shortened lead time, faster mean time to recovery, the usual promises. But I don't know how you feel, but I'm a person, if I have to do the same tedious work over and over again without some automation, always doing something manual, it's really exhausting. And it sometimes feels like the mythology of Sisyphus, where you can do the same task again and again. For him, it was punishment. And I hope for you, listeners, that you don't have to experience the same kind of punishment. For me, DevOps is more or less comparable with the manufacturer of cars. So you want to have standardized, automatized, repeatable, and reproducible steps, which act all together to make your life more comfortable and more predictable. So before everything starts, I think one point which is in many times not considered right is do a proper planning and define a proper acceptance criteria, what you want to do. If I would stand in front of you in a classic lecture hall, I would ask the question, how many of you have regularly experienced that there were some confusion within the project and you had to do post fixes, hot glue solutions, whatever, which made the code ugly and your life way more horrible. I would assume almost everyone would raise their hands. And I think this is a really important prerequisite, even though it's not necessarily a key feature of DevOps. So in theory, it's always goes this way. First, do a proper planning, then write the code. It can look in various ways. Build your construct, test your constructs, really test your stuff. Do a release, but with the release and deployment, it's not done. You do the operation, you monitor your operation, see what works, what does not work, and this is used for the next iteration. And this loop goes and goes and goes if done right. But like I was saying before, it's all about the tools. You can use a tool right, and you can use a tool wrong. If you do it in a wrong manner, it's less effective, more painful, more time consuming, and nobody will be happy. So let's start with a few important concepts. I think one of the major concepts is pet versus kettle. Previously, you used in an environment your cat as a cute little machine where, or applicable to servers, you used it as a cute little machine where you hand-fed everything.
Silence.
Where you fed everything manually and had all the configuration and took care of it if it was ill, misbehaved. You spent a lot of time making your cute little application work again. However, the trend goes more to kettle, and with kettle it's referred to more or less identical servers where you don't have to spend the time with hideous manual configuration. Okay, 1 second. Does this work or is it better? What do I have? Okay, sorry. You want to have more or less identical servers which give you or save you the time you have to spend for a setup, for configuration, and if something does not behave as intended, as hard as it sounds, you get rid of this instance and rather start afresh instead of spending all the time to make it work again. Okay, so for me, it boils down to this. You want to be fast, reproducible. This is illustrated with these more or less identical pictograms. And most importantly, you don't want to have a major process in your product, but you want to be immutable, since you want to have the same state, which is not changing. You want to have the same instance, and this makes things way easier to start, to stop, to restart, to debug. So, pet versus kettle, how bad can it be? I think everyone has a story to tell about this. I think I take one of the most basic examples, most likely everyone experienced this far. There are some people out there who confuse a pet with a kettle and say a container, in this case, behaves like a kettle. So I start a container, set it up, store everything in my container. Everything looks good. Unless you get a panicked call, where are my data? Or all the configurations are gone. What happened? What did you do? What could have happened? Okay, then you go patiently to the person who said this and start explaining the concept of a container, how a container works, and so on and so forth. This is another part, not just managing your part, but do the communication, do the education. Another one of my favorites is there are some applications which represent more or less a monolith. I hope everyone in this stream is familiar with the concept of a monolith or with the term monolith in applications. If not, usually it's referred to a huge behemoth of application which does almost everything, has a huge demand on resources, is more or less tiresome to set it up, to keep it running, and it's really hard to make it reproducible. I wish for you listeners that you would never have to experience something like this. In the theory, it's possible, but you don't do yourself a favor trying to put a beer moth in a container if it's not really necessary. And usually you hear, why does it fail? Why can't I restart it? Why can't I scale it? Why? Why? You get the point. It's really hard to make it work. And yes. In principle, one should prefer the GNU principle. Each program should do one thing and do it well. Nothing more, nothing less. And I'm really a fan of this principle because it saves you so much hassle and makes things way more easier for you to maintain it or set it up, whatever. So just as a short summary, if applicable, please try to use microservices. I'm aware that not in every environment you can run microservices, but then you can still try to go with customized images, be it a container image or Gordon VM image. Some applications allow it and make your life way easier. At least it saves you the hideous configuration part. You can always use configuration management tools. Nothing is worse than doing everything manually. It is way too time consuming and way too error prone. So another basic concept is the glory pipeline, the holy pipeline of a CI/CD, which follows more or less the same what I told you before. You do your planning, code and rebuild, and check whether this works, test it, deploy it, operate it, and this goes round and round with a lot of feedback mechanisms. But we live in not an ideal world and have some fun with this part. So once again, I love this monkey users comic strips, which point out really something nice, and I think you experienced this as well if you did something like this. Testing procedure can be optimized to catch a few set of known bugs or issues, but if you change a minor thing, then it can crash. Or you do not consider all cases, or you introduce some new cases and your testing scenarios go around the bug and you don't see it. Commonly known, I would say, these points are the ones I encountered most in my last years, that you had outdated libraries. Or you, in a CI/CD pipeline, you had to perform tedious installation steps which should have been in the Gordon image, but now you waste like 1 minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes for each step of the pipeline, which accumulates really fast to a lot of time. If you run a pipeline like 20 times a day or 30 times a day, you spend maybe 1 hour in some. You really have to try optimize it. Lacking tests, this is really a part which is omitted in most cases or many cases. Or you had once tests, but they are not working. And personally, my favorite is you have to do a lot of manual steps and settings to make the pipeline work in the first place, not as the continuous integration says, I push my code and everything starts. If I'm lucky, it works. If I'm not lucky, I have to work on the part which failed. But well, for this CI/CD topic, I think we can talk for hours what can go wrong there. But I think this are the these points I encounter the most. How can you do better? I would say, take care of your pipeline. The pipeline develops like a product does. usually your product get new libraries or new features, and then you have to adjust your pipeline for it. You can omit some previous code, but don't take it granted. Please consider when is the time to adjust it appropriately. Because I've seen states where there was a huge drift and it made life really hard to debug, to figure out what's wrong. Or there were some new features introduced for the pipeline or the pipeline tools, which enabled you way easier debug opportunities, but you still had to stick with some workarounds. But after all, we do care about our kettle. That even though I said before, if some instance does not work as intended, rather start a new one and start afresh, but nonetheless, we want to know the state of our kettle, of our applications, deployment, infrastructure, you name it. Logging and monitoring is a topic which deals with it, and yeah, it's sometimes behavior like a stepmother to their child that, I don't need it, or who cares about it? If it goes boom, somebody complains about it. Yes, indeed. We all know these stories. But what I experienced within the last years, 1 second. You can encounter false alarms. You set up alarms with your monitoring or logging, but get false alarms. They are more dangerous than you might think in the first place, because you get desensitized for it. If you get the same alarm like 50 times a day, then you stop noticing it or stop caring about it. And if one instance of these 50 instances were a real alarm and you didn't deal that with it appropriately, you can run in trouble really, really fast. So it can be tricky, but please try to make them right. Almost as dangerous as false alarms are missing alarms. If you don't notice something and rate until the worst case arrives, it can ruin your day or week or weekend. If you would have caught it earlier, might have been a bug fix for a single machine for like 10, 15 minutes, apply this patch to the other machines. Nobody would have noticed, nobody would have screamed, but if you really wanted to go the whole destructive way, and I've been there, then you have something like this. One really cute feature was also that you usually try to store your monitoring or logging databases for a certain degree of time. But if the database never left the state of proof of concept or initial design and did not major with your infrastructure, applications, you name it, then it might crash and every data is gone. Maybe you are lucky and it's not that important, but I would never go with this attitude. There are some customer or companies which have really, really strict audit rules, be it some pharmaceutical companies or some companies with sensitive data. They really have to take care of this part. Or some really cute feature is you want to open your logging or monitoring tool of choice. If you select something like more than 2 hours, it almost crashes the server. Nobody can use it. The second or the previous one and this one can boil down to the real problem that one considered not the right things to work with. Another point, which is luckily easy to fix if you know your application, are multi-line stack traces are not parsed correctly. I'm thinking of error messages of Java code, of Python code, you name it. We get an error message, can occur, and then one has to manually parse everything together because one person forgot to check a certain box or enter one line in a configuration file. Okay, 1 second. Okay. Let's try again. For these multi-line stack traces, usually one line in the configuration file fixes this problem. Okay, so how do you can do better? First of all, select only meaningful matrices or logs. I mean, it is nice to know what is the water level of your coffee machine, that you don't have to fill it up when you go next to the coffee machine, but you don't really have to log it at a 1 second interval together with your whole infrastructure, because this takes too much resources or too much resources which would be, have been needed elsewhere, be it for the current display, for queries, for databases, whatever. Logs is the same topic. Really be selective what you choose. I mean, for the beginning, it looks nice that you can have a lot of pretty and interesting features, but in practice, usually it boils down to maybe 5, maybe 10, or at most 20 matrices or logs you're really interested in. The rest, you can, if you want to have them in a less frequent interval, you can log them or store them separately or put them in a different instance. Sometimes it helps to adjust the query interval of your matrices. Do you really need to have some matrices at a 1 second interval? In some cases, a 5 minute interval is fine too. Really take your time and think about what do you really need. In retrospective, it saves you so much time and headaches. Then for queries, okay, then for queries and dashboards, the same goes there. I know there are some people who love a lot of colorful dashboards which might have hidden information or messages within them because they are so vast, so plentiful. But like I said before, sometimes it boils down to a few key features you are interested in. And this saves a lot of resources if you really reduce it to the maximum what you are interested in. In some cases, it's more applicable to do separate dashboards for separate tasks instead of having all on one view. And most importantly, know your application. You have to know what does it need, how do you set it up right, and so on and so forth. It happened a lot that I went to places and see, yeah, we have this running, and you look at it and you see, yeah, the setup is almost identical with the manufacturer's quick start guide, and then it stopped there. Maybe the security was omitted. Maybe a lot of matrices were still being entered, and so on and so forth. Or it runs permanently at the limit of your stack. Please take your time, spend this time, and know your application. I'm agnostic in whatever application you use, but please spend the time there. You save yourself and your colleagues a lot of headaches if you do it well. So, one of the points I was mentioning before, regular updates. This is another sad story. I wouldn't preach latest is greatest, but if I would stand in front of you, I would ask, raising your hand, if you know someone, and actually referring to yourself, who has some applications in your main stack, which might be have a state of 1 year ago, 2 years ago. We could start a game and saying who has the oldest state of their application running. This is a sad truth, and yeah, keep up to date. This comic strips illustrates the troubles you can encounter. If you do an upgrade first or update, it might crash. The documentation is close to non-existent. You might encounter some weird examples, but not really fit to your case. Community might be weird or non-existent or don't care. And in the end, you might be confronted with one of these points. How to do better? I cannot stress it out enough. Do regular updates. It really gives you a gut feeling and a better routine. Because if you have a smaller interval between your updates, the likelihood that you introduce some breaking changes is way less. And if you have a breaking change, you might have to spend like 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes most for one breaking change. But if you do a real huge jump in your update or in your state of your application, you might have to deal with so many breaking changes that you either cannot perform this update in one step, or you have to spend days, if not weeks, to deal with all these changes. And if you have a routine in doing your updates, you know the places which go wrong. You build up a certain degree of experience. What to do if you encounter this problem? Where you have to look, where you have to do adjustments? Because the more experience and routine you have, the easier goes the debugging process. I really can advise it to you. And still, I don't say latest is greatest. You have some policies. You do have to do some previous checks, whatever. But again, please don't run some ancient versions of your software, be it for features, be it for security aspects. Try to do it. If possible, try to couple your update routine with a CI/CD pipeline. Because the less manual steps you have, the easier it goes for you. Of course, I know it can fail and you have to intervene anyway, but if you do it well in your pipeline, you might have regularly the case, oh, the update went, I have the latest version, I have the latest features, and didn't have to do anything. Once again, know your application, know your stuff. It helps you a lot, and especially it helps to reduce human errors. Even if you have to consider the guy who always does the updates is on vacation, or hopefully in the current times, not somewhere else, then your work does not go a full stop. And like I said before, it's the similarity between minor versions or closely related versions is usually higher and saves you a lot of hassle. Another problem I regularly encounter are initial deployments, be it an application, be it infrastructure, it doesn't matter. But I think this strip again boils it down. You have an initial deployment and it's called production ready. But if you look under the hood, these green things are illustrated as bugs. You encounter a pretty frail construct with copy-paste hot glued solution, and you don't want to have something like this in production. But you always have to keep in mind, if it works, if it compiles, ship it is not the right procedure to go. You have to take into account and maybe talk to your supervisors about these points too, because some of them usually try to forget them, that initial deployments require a longer development time, require room for tests and failures. Better have a failure in your development phase than in production. It can go horribly wrong. And get all things together can take some time as well. So especially if you try to set up some more or less customized microservices solution. And usually multiple iterations are necessary. You don't click one button and everything goes well for your initial deployment. Even if you take some previous code from someone else, you have to do your adjustments and maybe challenge that code to make it suitable for your environment. For running deployments, one can encounter something like this, that you add features and features and features, and in the end you are in front of a whole mess. Or you have possible code contents. We could play some kind of bingo with these points, and I assume one of you have at least encountered one of these points. What I want to say is, even if it works for you for a midterm period or a long-term period, if your application or deployment ages with time, usually you rather add more things than remove things. But over the time, you might encounter weird behavior due to one or the other. And I think there are too many examples to go through, and one could talk hours about it, but how do you do better? I would say challenge your code regularly. It sounds easy, but it is not. If you encounter a part which is poorly written, or causing trouble, or does some black magic, and you cannot imagine how many times I encountered a comment which said, "Don't touch it, black magic. Don't even dare to touch it, it breaks everything down." Don't know why I see these comments. It's no joke. And you'd want to avoid them completely. And if you see there are some obsolete code parts or obsolete features you can get rid of, or are taken over by some other libraries, please try to refactor it. It's not only for your convenience or the customer's convenience, but also for your colleagues' convenience. Everything profits if you do it. And everyone wants to do sprints with Scrum or whatever techniques are involved. I don't want to start there, but in the end, whatever method you are using, please try to account regularly time for refactoring or doing adjustments to your code base. I know in theory it all sounds nice and everyone goes hand in hand together, but usually you get pressure from above, but you have to have a good basis on your colleagues or supervisors who give you this space. I know in theory it sounds all good and well, but you really have to make awareness for this point. Because it's not once or twice I encountered it, and I would bet with you, most of you have encountered it as well, that you say it's obvious to make these changes, to fix up this huge mess, or if you're getting gray hair just thinking about touching certain libraries or code fragments. And you know someone would have take care of it, but you always get pressured, put in new features. But maybe the persons who are managing it are not aware of it. Try to make this awareness. It really helps you. Because historically grown features and code base you encounter regularly. In some cases, it's a mess after like 1 month. In some cases, it's a mess after 2 years. It gets a mess sooner or later if you don't have the discipline there. Yeah, test environment and production environment. Another really, really fun topic. And I would bet with you, if you have the luxury of a testing environment, use it. But this strip illustrates, well, even if something runs in your test environment, it's not granted that it's worked for you in your production environment for various reasons. I think everyone working in this environment can have a story on their own. And I just want to make awareness for it. I mean, what I have seen, or I heard some excuses, so to say. For some people or departments, it's well known, it's just a bad habit to skipping testing environment or environments a whole and just do it in production because it's a bad habit. Or you hear something like this, why should I go to all these testing instances, all these testing environments, ask the customer or colleague is really annoying, pressuring me really hard. I just go directly fix it there. It's obvious what has to be done. Or you hear something like, there are too many urgent things to do. I don't want to spend all my attention on this testing procedure and go straight to the root cause. Or you have this situation that you don't have appropriate resources for testing environment, that you have only in theory a testing environment, but in practice, if you visit your testing environment, you cannot do anything at all because you cannot start a puny container rich runs the minimal requirements of your applications. And this case, it's really sad. But the aforementioned points lead to something like someone did a quick change, maybe used the wrong user or the wrong permissions or didn't thought about the permissions. Then you want to go the proper procedure and it fails. And it says something like, permissions not allowed or the folder does not exist. I've been there. And please, if you have this environment or automatic pipeline, use it. Don't try to use a shortcut because you make your life or the life of your colleagues more miserable if you try to do something like this. And sometimes these temporary solutions become permanent solutions and then the real nightmare starts, believe me. Yeah, how to do better? I think the first and most important point is be disciplined. Even it looks tempting at the first glance, do the proper procedure, do the proper steps. Because sometimes you think, this is an obvious solution, it can be easily fixed, and I'm the great hero after all, I'm thinking about all things which might turn up, and then you break production. A downtime of 2 hours, 6 hours. Some customers are not happy having something like this, and you don't want to go this road. On the other hand, plan your resources appropriately. Of course, a testing environment does not necessarily have to be a full-blown setup as your production environment. Sometimes it's okay to go with some minimal requirements or with a little buffer, a little bit more. But having no resources for testing, it's not a good idea. And you have to consider that maybe you have to adjust your testing environment too. Your application might need, or your deployment might need way more resources over the time. It might have worked 2 years ago, but with the set of features you added, it does not work anymore. Or you have junked up all your environment, and this applies to testing and production as well. And just didn't do a cleanup. Your pipelines does not work again anymore because you have too many cached container images for which are outdated ages ago. Same applies for virtual machines, whatever. Try to do these cleanups regularly. In best case, do it in an automated manner. And be smart. Spend some time. Do some great code and save yourself and your colleagues a lot of headaches. Another point I regularly encounter are inefficient constructs. I'm a great fan of Ansible as a configuration management tool. And I don't know who uses Ansible 2 of the listeners, but let me tell you this. In Ansible, you can do operations in a looped manner. Some of these applications or tasks are, for example, installing an application with the packet manager of your choice. But I've seen constructs where people run a loop with these packet managers. And if you think about it, how this works in the background, for each iteration of the loop, it does a new, for example, apt update, updates its database, caches database, checks for the states, checks for dependencies, and so on and so forth. Even though this application can utilize multiple arguments and does not need a loop for it, and it can save you a lot of time, doing this minor adjustment, just using an array or list instead of your loop can save you a lot of time. On the other hand, I've seen something like you have a pipeline, and in each stage, the container does a whole installation procedure, which might take 5 minutes, which might take in half an hour. And yeah, it sums up really fast. Or if you really have to resort to something like this, you use the wrong mirrors. In a Linux environment, you usually have a whole bunch of available mirrors. Some of the default settings are something like archive mirror, which is not that fast and maybe not closest to your location. Doing this minor change might save you a lot of time too. Or you have local mirrors. This goes even faster. And you cannot imagine how much time you waste if you just ignore this point. Believe me. Next point is security management. And this is another point which is really, really sad and not dealt with appropriately. I've seen a lot of places where it's a security by obscurity. So they just use such weird constructs that it's almost a security concept to make it hard to understand it. I think this strip illustrates the problem quite well. I've seen things like passwords which were committed to Git, for example. I've seen, or I have a cute anecdote. One wanted to run a certain application, set his favorite password, and the maintainer of the application hard-coded an exception that if this password, which was coincidentally the same as the favorite password of the other guy, the application won't start. Or you have some key stores, vaults, you name it, but you don't use them, or you don't use them right. Just doing some manual copy-pasting or something like this is not really different. Best case scenario, you automate it in a manner that you don't have to intervene and you don't have to know the password yourself. So just a script which generates automatically your passwords, certificates, tokens, you name it, inserted in a secure way in your pipeline, container orchestration, configuration management tools. There are a lot of connectors for these. And also make an entry in your key store that you yourself don't have to bother about the password. You just set a few rules that the password meets certain criteria. And on the other hand side, you are on a safe side. So if you don't have to regularly mess with the keys or tokens or whatever. Because sometimes there's a bad apple in the root or in the process, and you can avoid it in this manner. Another cute thing is what I've seen, you have too many tools doing the same thing. Like you have to consider 2 to 3 different places of documentations or version control systems or some things or 3 applications doing the same, but in a slightly different manner instead of refactoring the code that only one is utilized. This makes up a lot of confusion. And believe me, I don't make up this point. This is really a horrible situation. And you have to think half of the day, which information goes where? Where do I have to take care of it? Where do I have to do adjustments? Am I missing some points? And this is horrible. Please try to stick with one tool of your choice and know how to use it. Resource management, I think I can skip over it since I mentioned it multiple times before. Do your resource management well. Not only have enough resources, but use your resources in a balanced manner. You cannot run on the same hypervisor all your memory intensive or computing intensive tasks and wondering for some misbehavior. Like I was mentioning before, I'm a fan of the GNU principle. Keep it simple. If something looks too complicated for you, if something looks like a complete mess, or you feel like you have to have a PhD to only get the first level of this code documentation, whatever, challenge it. Sometimes some people try to hide their knowledge that they actually don't have it. Sometimes it's just bad habit. If a code looks too difficult, then maybe the code is not right. Try to fix it or use a different tool or application for it. As I was mentioning before, know your applications. I cannot stress it out enough. Know your applications. Know what you are doing. It's really, really sad how many things I encountered in this regard. Documentation. I left this page out blank to represent the state of documentation I encountered. In many cases, it went from close to non-existent to outdated to non-applicable. A friend of mine who is really mean in this regard, he does not merge a merge request or pull request of new features if not these new features or variables or whatever were adjusted in the documentation. The one person who wanted to do this fixes, features, whatsoever, will hate him. But all his other colleagues, which might have to work in future with this documentation, are really happy that they can see, okay, read me, these variables are used. I can stick with it and don't have to do something close to reverse engineering, digging through all the code, figuring out what is the right resource, how or a variable, how is it used right. Technical depths, I think everyone knows it, that you proceed with something, ignored the mess you piled up in behind, and at one point all your card house crashes together and you're spending more time on doing firefighting than development of your features. Knowledge islands is a different problem. I just skipped through it. This means that only 1% or a very small amount of person knows the topic or the application or the code. And if this is not shared and this person is the so-called bus count is hit by a bus and cannot come to work or in the current times is not available for health reasons or whatever, then everything stands still and you don't want to have that. You want to have a common knowledge base that everyone can continue there, or at least the number should be as great as possible. Therefore, communication is key. I cannot stress it out enough. Communication is key. You have to talk to your colleagues. You have to talk to your supervisors. Humans cannot read minds, as sad as it sounds, but some people are not aware of certain points. Sometimes you spend days or weeks on a problem and then talking in a coffee break with your colleague and saying, oh, I'm getting headache with this feature. And he said, oh, I encountered this last week ago, just do one, add this one command and everything is solved. You're doing so and thinking, why didn't I ask him or her sooner? If some people go for a coffee break or a smoke break, join them. You don't have necessary to start smoking or start drinking coffee or whatever, but just get your colleagues to know well, just to get in touch with them, to do some kind of bonding with them, really helps you because sometimes you encounter that they have the solution of your problem or have very well knowledge of your problem and whatsoever. It really helps you and accelerates the steps a lot. In the end, after all these topics, I want to say, you can do it. You can do it. The most important thing I would just want to say, sum up, don't be indifferent. Challenge the situation. Don't take for granted what is, and don't take it for given. If you encounter something which is not right, try to build up a community, try to talk to your supervisor, try to make some room to do these adjustments. And the most important part, talk to each other. Lastly, just if you encounter some of the previous problems and want to support, my colleagues and I are happy to help you. And with this, I want to thank you for your attention. And I don't know how it looks with open questions, but thank you very much. And a short shout out to our everyday heroes in the current times, like the people in the health system, the shopping systems or delivery. I think they're doing an amazing job, even despite the current situation. Thank you.